And on each of the occasions I had the opportunity to interact with the late Prime Minister, I had absolutely no doubt in my mind that before us was one of the most astute and intellectually minded figures who have recently traversed the African continent. I in fact had occasion to joke with him once that if he had not been a politician and a head of government, he probably would have made an outstanding university professor. His capacity to synthesize a debate and to come out with a common consensus position around issues that were controversial was for me quite a legendary one. But much more than this is the fact that coming out of a context of struggle and of war, he set the stage for what we can now safely describe as the Renaissance of Ethiopia, an old civilization which for a long period traversed periods of difficulty and in seeking to rediscover itself had the fortune to have Mele Zenawi as its leader, a person who then dedicated himself to the task of constructing what he described as a new developmental state project for Ethiopia. A project which I guess many of us see on a day-to-day basis as Ethiopia transforms before our very eyes. Doing so, I should emphasize, and this has been repeated in other contexts, in a situation in which it is not exactly a resource-driven transformation. If other countries of the continent are today experiencing forms of transformation underpinned by a commodity boom, whether it be minerals or agricultural commodities, Ethiopia's transformation is coming from sources other than those commodities. And it is a salute to the vision and to the determination which Mele Zenawi mustered that I think we see the change which is taking place, enabling us, I think, to have the hope that Africa can transcend the limitations of commodities in order to put itself on a sustainable path towards transformation. For me, perhaps more than any other contribution which he made, it is for this that Mele Zenawi will be remembered, and for which, for my own generation of African intellectuals who have argued all along that Africa cannot turn the table of underdevelopment if it does not pay attention to the important role which a developmental state that is able to deploy and manage the forces of the market in directions that will enable us to achieve structural transformation is established, then we would continue to wallow in the dark. As a leader of Renaissance, therefore, I think it is to his credit that Ethiopia today is able to overcome the long experience, which is also the experience shared by many African countries, of simply being reduced to the management of poverty, and now hoping to be able to manage prosperity and wealth in the context of an all-around transformation. And I know that in the context of the work which we do on the continent, not only within our universities, but also in institutions such as the United Nations Economic Commission for Africa, under the leadership of Mr. Carlos Lopes, we see also a movement which is beginning to take place to accompany the work of change and transformation which is unfolding on our continent with ideas that can help Africa to claim the 21st century. And Ethiopia, a long and old civilization, will clearly have an important role to play in that narrative of claiming the 21st century. But there's also a second reason which made this an attractive proposition to me when it was offered last night. And it is the fact that the theme of the 2014 Mele Zenawi lecture is focused on Nelson Mandela, a hero to all of us in every sense of the word. And if the naming of the series after Mele Zenawi was itself a masterstroke from the Tana Forum, the choice of the focus on the legacy of Nelson Mandela can only be applauded as one which is worthy of celebration. Because few are the personalities who, in the recent history of the world, were able to leave their mark in the sands of time as visionary leaders who were driven by a determination to fight oppression and injustice, no matter the cost to them personally. I know that a lot has been written and said about Nelson Mandela, and that also makes it somewhat difficult to find an original angle from which to begin to talk about his legacy, especially with regard to leadership. I do so nevertheless acknowledging that Nelson Mandela's experience and example was a testament to the largeness of the man and the richness of his multidimensional nature, or the multidimensional nature of his experience. As a person who led by example, who paid the supreme price in the loss of his liberty, and who declared himself and meant every declaration which he made to that effect, that he was prepared to give up his life if only to hold on to the convictions and the beliefs which he had. It is not something which too many people are able to make, even if we take it for granted that such declarations as Nelson Mandela made in 1964 at his trial stood out perhaps as one of the most important testaments that he left for us. However, I would like to focus on three key elements which seem to me to be aspects of the legacy and experience of Nelson Mandela which haven't been adequately drawn upon, and which a reading and rereading of his life experience will teach us as being essential and necessary ingredients for the challenges and the tasks which confront us in Africa today. For all the admiration which has been expressed in his favor, for all the acclaim which has been said in his name, for all the adulation which has been poured out, especially in the immediate aftermath of his passing, acclamation, adulation, and praise, which almost suggests that in Nelson Mandela we had something close to a saint, there were for me three basic elements of his life which, though usually missed out, often speak to the most important legacy which we can carry forward. The first of them is what I call the capacity to dream, the capacity of a leader to dream. Because a leader who is not able to articulate the aspirations and hopes of a people whom he or she leads into a dream that translates into a wider and broader vision of society, out of which projects of transformation, ideas of change, and hopes of renewal can be built, is little more than a manager of day-to-day affairs. In the midst of the struggle for the liberation of South Africa, many were those who came up with different aspects of a strategy for dealing with the problems posed to the black community by the apartheid system that had been put in place. It was for Nelson Mandela to rise above the quotidian, to rise above the day-to-day, and to abstract all of the hopes and aspirations of the black majority of South Africa into a dream which he expressed at his trial. And that dream was summarized in his hope of a non-racial society. I think sometimes we take it for granted that the role of dreams and visions in the makings of nation, in the making of nations, and in the building of societies is so central to any hope of transformation that we sometimes laugh at those who say they have a dream, not only for their countries, but even for their continent. It was precisely out of the dreams which the founding fathers of the African continent and the founding mothers of the continent, those who fought for the liberation of Africa, of Kwame Nkrumah, of even those going back to Marcus Garvey, who dreamt of an African Renaissance, that we had independence delivered to us. Much in the same way as Kennedy's dream of landing a man on the moon became an important rallying and organizing principle for the American society of his generation until it was achieved. Out of dreams come visions of transformation, and out of visions come the blueprints and possibilities for change which we would want to see in our society. I fear though that in the context of our contemporary situation in Africa, we seem to be too preoccupied, too overwhelmed by the demands of the times, by the pressures of the day-to-day, that we have not been able to throw out sufficient leadership of the divide that will encapsulate all of our hopes and our aspirations, of our pains and of our travails, into dreams which we can identify ourselves with, and which can then become organizing and disciplining principles around which we can hope to transform our continent. Nelson Mandela dreamt. It was his good fortune that although he spent 27 years in jail for his audacity to dream of a non-racial South Africa, he was fortunate to come out of prison to lead South Africa as its first democratically elected president, elected by all of the races of South Africa. And few would have failed to be moved by the fact that at his funeral, we saw the full complexion of the South African society in all of its shades of color troop out in large numbers in order to give him a befitting farewell. Because out of the dream which he forged, every South African, like every one of us around the world, could recognize a little bit of ourselves in the life and example of the man. A second element of the life of Nelson Mandela, which is not often sufficiently harped upon in much of the praise which is justifiably heaped on him, on his legacy, centers around what I call a local embeddedness. A local embeddedness which I consider to be also indispensable to the art of leadership. No leader can meaningfully help to drive society in a direction which is desirable if such a leader is not fully embedded in the immediate social context that defines the political community in which he or she operates. We know, of course, that there have been offshore governor generals in the history of our continent, and there are indeed leaders of our continent who spend more of their time outside of the continent running the affairs of state than in the countries which we are supposed to be heading. When the will of Nelson Mandela was released, it was not difficult to see the depth of the embeddedness of the man, even though he spent 27 years out of circulation. Beginning from his native Kunu, where he was recognized as one of the most important players on the ground, not just because of his chieftaincy, but also because of the active role which he played in day-to-day community life before he went to jail and after he came out of prison. There was also his alma mater, the various institutions which he went to, which he considered to be part of the broader community that he owed a responsibility towards. There was, of course, the context of his own family, both immediate and extended, and the broader South African and African family, which defined much of the Mandela world. Such a depth of embeddedness makes it possible for a leader both to derive mandate, but also to have a reality check on himself or herself at any point in time. And it is inconceivable that any leader could hope to transform a society who does not fully know the sociology and the psychology of the people whom he or she leads. The alienation which seems to mark much of the relationship between leaders and those whom they lead on the African continent is partly explained by this disconnect of leadership from the immediate context that demands the leadership acumen which Africans want to see. And I consider that as we reflect on the challenges of leadership on our continent today, we must insist that the beginning of leadership must be at home on the African continent. That it is we as citizens of the continent who will judge those who lead us in a world in which too many are often too keen outside of the continent to determine for us who is the good African leader and who is the bad African leader. Indexes of various kinds have been produced to even try to rank leaders around the world and to tell us what is good for us in Africa in terms of leadership and what may not be good for us on the continent. Nelson Mandela may have been acclaimed by the world, but Nelson Mandela did not fail to ensure that he was rooted and embedded in the local context of South Africa, from which he came out and to which he owed primary accountability and responsibility, and out of which he defined the framing of relationships with the rest of the world. Such was the manner of leadership, therefore, that even as he was acknowledged by the world inevitably as one of the greatest personalities of the last 100 years of human history, he also was not one who was going to be dictated to by anybody, except by his conscience and what he considered to be in the best interest of justice and of the peoples of South Africa and the larger African world. There is a lesson, it seems to me, in all of this. We have seen leaders on the African continent who have been crowned by the outside world and praised for as long as they were useful to the outside world. Their usefulness sometimes only understood in terms of the extent to which they were able either to trade off the interests of their countries to those of bigger powers in the international system, or indeed even to betray their populations for the sake of adulation from other parts of the world. We do not hear much of this in the life of Nelson Mandela, but it is one which I believe we must take seriously. At a time, especially when different players in the international system, at a time of change in the world, are busily fashioning out goals and objectives of what they want to see of Africa in the near future for the benefit of themselves, first and foremost. A third element and the final aspect of the Mandela story, which has appealed tremendously to me, is what I have, for want of a better word, called the inevitable interconnection of great leadership with controversy. I have had occasion to discuss the experiences of great personalities in Africa's recent history with students of various categories, and many would say to me that Kwame Nkrumah, for example, may have been a great man, but he was controversial. Nelson Mandela did not have a shortage of controversy in his life, whether it be in his personal life or indeed even in his broader political choices that he made. Controversy was almost the middle name of the icon. That, of course, is a narrative which has been played down in much of the discourse. Mandela, to his credit, in his autobiography, was one of the very first to admit to some of his own weaknesses and failings as a human being. And I think there is here for us an important lesson going forward, that in building a new generation of African leaders, a generation of leaders who will be able to rise to the challenges of the 21st century, many as they are and in their different forms and complexions, that we begin to understand that leadership accompanied by controversy in the international geopolitical system has been one in which our continent has been worsted. It was a context of change which produced the slave trade. It was a context of change which produced the colonial era. It was a context of change which produced the partition. Rebuilding Africa in the context of the current process of change in the international system is a task which we cannot take for granted.